Hello, my name is Frank DiStassi, and I'm an applications engineer here at Texas Instruments. And today we're going to be looking at the EMI of a non-synchronous buck converter. Now, many engineers believe that it's almost impossible to get the same good EMI performance from a non-synchronous regulator as it is from a synchronous converter. And today we're going to show you how to get just as good performance from a non-synchronous regulator as you can from a synchronous converter. So first, let's take a look at the differences between a synchronous and a non-synchronous converter. We see on this slide on the left-hand side a typical synchronous buck converter. Now we can see that the power MOSFETs, M1 and M2, are inside the IC, so therefore they're in very close proximity. The input capacitor is also very, very close to the IC because it's physically smaller than the IC itself. Now, the critical loop that we have to deal with when dealing with EMI is between the input capacitors and the two MOSFET transistors that you see here. The reason that this loop, this current loop, is critical is that the currents in the loop are changing very fast. They're turning on and off at a very rapid rate. And that's basically what causes both conducted and radiated EMI. So the whole key to minimizing your EMI is to keep that critical loop area very, very small, or at least as small as possible. Basically what happens is that small loop between the input capacitors and the power MOSFETs creates a small antenna that radiates EMI. Now, if we look over here on the right-hand side, we see a typical non-synchronous converter. In this case, we have a Schottky diode that takes the place of transistor M2, and that's the key difference between these two power supplies. Because the Schottky diode is external and physically larger than typically the input capacitor or the IC sometimes, that necessitates the current loop to be actually a little bit larger than it is in a synchronous converter for the same current rating and the same voltage and power ratings. So you can see here, basically, with a non-synchronous converter, you're almost forced to have a slightly larger critical loop area than you do for a synchronous converter. Now here's a typical example of a layout for a synchronous converter. On the right-hand side, you see the IC itself with the two power MOSFETs inside, and you see the input capacitor right next to it, physically very close. So you can see by moving the input capacitor as close as possible to the IC, that current loop area is going to be very small. In this case, the dotted red line signifies the critical loop area that we're trying to minimize. In the non-synchronous converter, it's easy to see that we have the Schottky diode designated as D1, which is actually a little bit larger than the IC itself and quite a bit larger than the input capacitor. So it makes it a little bit difficult to get all the components as close as possible. A little bit more difficult than it is in a synchronous converter, but it's not impossible to get a good tight loop. But you can see here from the dotted box that represents the critical loop area, that it's always going to be a little bit more than for a synchronous converter would be. So the question is, how do we get good EMI performance from a non-synchronous buck converter? Well, there are three basic principles you have to keep in mind. One, as we just mentioned, is to keep the critical loop area as physically small as possible. Second, use both a top side and a bottom side ground plane on your PC board. Those ground planes will help to manage the loop currents and keep them where you want them to flow. And finally, make sure that you use both common mode and differential mode filters on the input to your power supply. Those filters will help to filter out the fast rising edges of the currents in those critical current loops we just talked about. And in fact, the filters will help with both radiated and conducted EMI. So we have an example to show you here today. We have an evaluation board that was designed by TI engineers specifically to minimize both conducted and radiated EMI. And essentially the board has a very tight loop area, as we mentioned. It has both topside and bottom side ground planes, and it has both differential and common mode input filters. This particular board is based on the LMR16030 simple switcher non-synchronous buck converter. So this is what we'll use as our example today in our lab to see what kind of EMI performance we can get. So the next step is we'll take this board into the lab, into the EMI chamber, and go ahead and run an EMI scan. So here we are inside of our EMI chamber, and we have the PC board we saw earlier set up and ready to go to run an EMI scan. The input power supply to our PC board is a pair of 12-volt batteries in series that gives us 24 volts for our input supply. And it's very important to use batteries whenever you're doing any kind of EMI testing because they provide a very low noise source for our regulator. The output of this particular regulator is designed to provide 5 volts with a load current of 3 amps. And again, we also need some very low noise load. So what we choose to use for our load is essentially a set of power resistors that are non-inductive. And if you look underneath the turntable here, you will see that our load resistors are sitting on that heatsink out of the way so they don't interfere with anything else. On the opposite side of the corner to the PC board, we have our EMI receiving antenna. And essentially what will happen is that the EMI coming off of our PC board will be picked up by the antenna, sent through the coaxial cable, and into the receiver that's in the lab. So now we're all set to go back in the lab and run a scan. Well, we have our PC board inside the EMI chamber, and it's all powered up, and we're ready to run an EMI scan. So let's go ahead and run the receiver. So now the scan is completed. We just ran a radiated EMI scan over the frequency range of 30 megahertz to 1 gigahertz. And it's easy to see that our PC board has passed the CISPR 22 Class B limits. One thing to keep in mind is that the chamber we have here at TI is what's known as a 3-meter chamber. That means that the antenna is approximately 3 meters away from the PC board regulator that we're trying to test. Typically, however, in industry, the antenna will be approximately 10 meters away from the board under test. That means that typically the EMI results that you get at the antenna will be a little bit less than what we see here in our 3-meter chamber. So even though this EMI scan seems like it's coming very close to the CISPR limit, in reality it'll actually be a little bit further away. This slide shows us a comparison between a typical synchronous converter and the non-synchronous converter that we just scanned, essentially. These scans were taken with an industrial 10-meter chamber. The red graph is the non-synchronous and the black graph is the synchronous. It's easy to see that both converters easily pass the CISPR 22 Class B requirement. It's also easy to see that the non-synchronous converter at some frequency ranges will have a little bit more EMI than a comparable synchronous converter. And that's what you would expect because it's a little bit more difficult to get the critical loop area as small as it would be for a synchronous converter. So in summary, to achieve good EMI results from a non-synchronous converter, just keep in mind these 3 points. Keep the critical PC board loop area as small as possible. Use generous ground planes to keep the currents flowing in small loops. And use both common mode and differential mode input filters to help filter out some of the EMI noise generated by the switcher. So, there you have it. We've showed you today how you can minimize the amount of both radiated and conducted EMI in a non-synchronous design by following a few simple rules. So for more information, please see the links at the end of this video, and thank you for watching.